From coast to coast, live via satellite, it's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers major Christian events in America and across the world, covering over 500 million souls with the good news of new life in Jesus Christ. Now, from Calvary Temple in Irving, Texas, we invite you to be a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us on Praise the Lord for the Dallas Revival are nationally known evangelist James Robinson, former Muscle Brothers, now Soldiers for Jesus, Ken and Bill Henderson, ministry music recording artists Dino and Cheryl Kartanakis, Dean and Mary Brown, and Jeff Finhold. Now your hosts, president and founders of the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Paul and Jay.
Great to be in Big D, Dallas, Fort Worth, Irving, Colleyville, all the towns and cities in around this great Dallas Metroplex. Boy, you look wonderful tonight. Say something. We're just so excited about being here, have looked so forward to being here. Oh, Lord, we thought we were going to be here last Thanksgiving to have a great week of dedication, but it just didn't work out that way. But now the Lord's arranged it, and all Holy Week we're going to have a wonderful, wonderful time praising the Lord, thanking Him for Jesus, dedicating the wonderful new facilities here at Channel 58. Pastor J. Don George is over in the Holy Land, I guess, and couldn't be here tonight. So you know what we ought to do, Jan? Let's have James and Betty Robinson come and just say hello to everybody and lead us in our prayer. He'll be back to preach in a little bit. How you doing, brother?
I'm doing fine, Paul. Bless you. Welcome. We welcome you to the Metroplex. One more big Texas welcome to the TBN family. God bless you. We're glad you're here. And I can tell you in behalf of Don George, you are so welcome. He loves the entire body of Christ. He loves all the parts. And he is a real encourager. And we like this building here because our daughter was married right here in this church. And we actually put that wedding on television because some folks asked that we do it. And this was such a pretty place to have a wedding. And it was just wonderful. So we do welcome all of you. And Paul, Jan, God bless you. Now, do you want me to pray or what? Just all right. I just want to follow the script. I'll preach later. He's afraid I'll start preaching now. I know. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do thank you for Trinity Broadcasting Network. Father, we thank you for all the people that make it possible, for the people who watch this station, Channel 58, and all the other stations where TBN broadcasts the gospel. And Father, we have found the caliber of people who are interested in the message that's preached on the TBN network to be so encouraging, so Christ-like, so loving, so forgiving. And we thank you for that. And we just pray that even tonight, that viewers who will join us will find something other than religion. They'll find the very life that's available in Jesus only. We want them to know Jesus. So Father, bless in His name tonight. And to all of you who are watching, we want you to experience life. Not religion, but life that delivers from all the power of the enemy. We welcome you. Paul?
Thank you, brother. Hey. Thank you, James. Thank you, Betty. Isn't she the cutest little grandma you ever saw? Happy birthday. Jan just had her... And she is not sensitive about her age at all. Her 51st birthday. Boy, if there's any facelifts around here, I'm getting them. You're not. They'll be calling me your father here before long. Say hi to these good Texas folks.
Well, you can sit down, okay? Did you know we had planned for... Really, to make a very long story as short as we can, 15 years ago, we thought that the Lord was leading us to a station here in the Dallas area. Things happened and it didn't work out, but somehow we kept believing and knowing that someday we would be in Dallas with a full channel for TBN, for God's people in this wonderful area. And God has worked it out, and I think this is so beautiful, that on the holiest week of the year that we remember what Jesus did for us, Holy Week, the entire week is so beautiful. Ash Wednesday, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and then, of course, Resurrection Day. But the greatest week of the year honoring Jesus. He has allowed us to be here in Dallas in the beautiful new studio. And it's almost like you're having a lot of emotions. You want to be so honoring to Jesus Christ, our Savior. And yet we are so excited about being here. We want to jump and squeal. And so together we're just going to rejoice and have a beautiful time. Thank you for inviting us to be a part of your family here. We've heard about wonderful Texans all our lives, and now we've experienced it. You are wonderful. In fact, honey, as I was talking to my mother about kind of our family history in the last year of her life, and my grandmother Lofton, Bethany Lofton, was from Tyler, Texas, and their family all had lived in Tyler. So I guess our roots way back, my grandmother would be Tyler, Texas. And I just want to say one thing, because we've got so many wonderful guests tonight that I'm going to enjoy just listening to too. But thinking about Jesus and thinking about how Satan has tried to destroy me over the last 15 years with depression and pain of depression that nobody knows unless you go through it. You don't know the pain, but I know it. And Jesus has healed me of it. And all I know to say is... This Holy Week, my testimony is, because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Amen. And without Him, I wouldn't be able to. And I love you, and I love Jesus.
We had a little prayer partner seminar last night over at the beautiful new studios. By the way, how many have seen the White House look-alike over here on Irving Boulevard? Wave at me. Do you all approve? Do you like the style and the looks? I'll tell you, we're going to have a little landmark over there for you good old Texas folks, and I'm sure you're going to like the inside when you see it next week as well. But I said to a little group that had gathered to come and train and help us on the telephones, the prayer partner phone lines will be open now, and folks will be able to call in for prayer, for deliverance, for healing, for whatever. I said, look, Jan and I have in a large part done our part. We fought devils and demons and the FCC and everything, and made it through. We paid $3.5 million just for the license. Hello, Mike Evans. How you doing, brother, over there? God bless you. Mike's been a strong friend and supporter as well. Pastors a great church here. We raised the money. We paid the $3.5 million. We had to raise another $1.5 million or so to put the big heavy transmitter out at Cedar Hill and an antenna on the tower and got it on the air finally. And then for nearly 2 years, we've been under construction with the beautiful new studio. Now, Jan and I have done our part to a large extent. We'll still be back as often as we can. Kind of fallen in love with Texas, if you want to know the truth. And we'll come and do programming and have great rallies and just enjoy your company as much as we possibly can. But of course, we got 152 other babies to pray over and love and take care of and agonize over and protect from the enemy and so on. 153 stations in this network now. So, basically, what I'm trying to say to all of you wonderful Texas folks is, will you take this baby now? Will you take your Channel 58? Will you love it? Will you pray for it? Will you use it? Will you support it? Will you come see it? Will you maybe be a prayer partner and work on the telephones and lead people to Jesus and pray for them? We give you this mighty tool of communication. That's all a TV station is, you know. It's a tool. It's just a tool of communication. It's a big megaphone. We can talk to everybody. And boy, as I said a minute ago, sooner or later, they're all going to flip by. Someday, sometime, they're going to flip by and somebody, James Robinson's going to catch them and get them. And the Holy Spirit's going to convict and we're going to win them to Jesus. Yes, we are. We can do it with this big, beautiful tool of communication. That's all it is. But you know, if you read the Old Testament, when Solomon built that great temple, and by the way, you read some of the furnishings and things that went in that Old Testament temple, that's a doghouse back there, man. I mean, it's nothing. That's a Hollywood set. Everything's fake over there, you know. I mean, it's pretty, but it's nothing like the real gold overlay in the... But you know, Solomon knew that unless that Shekinah glory of God came down and filled that house, it would just be another building. It would just be four walls and a roof. And we know that too. And so that's why together we need to just invite the precious Holy Spirit now to come and fill every corner of that building and then out beyond it into the airwaves and ether waves to fill every nook and cranny of this whole Metroplex area with the glory, the Shekinah glory of God. Will you agree with me to that extent? That Dallas-Fort Worth and all of the regions beyond and wherever else this great satellite signal goes, that people will feel the mighty convicting hand of God and that they will want to know this Jesus that we love and that we worship and that we adore in a special way now this coming week during Holy Week. Can I count on you that for that, Texas? Can I really count on you for all that? I know I can. I know I can. I love you for that. Let me just read one little psalm here before Jeff Finholt comes to minister. I love them all, but Psalm 46 is very special. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. Whew. What a God we serve. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, Behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the ends of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Amen. Amen. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. I want you to give a great big Texas welcome and hello to a wonderful young man that is being used mightily of the Lord. Many of you will remember some years ago that tremendous Broadway musical called Jesus Christ Superstar. Jeff Finholt really didn't know Jesus at that time, but he sure does now. He traveled with a group for a time called Black Sabbath. We're not real proud of that chapter altogether. But I want to tell you something. The devil's not getting all of our kids. He sure isn't. Jesus is capturing many of them, and we're glad Jeff Finholt is one of them. From Altaloma, California, let's give Jeff Finholt a great big praise the Lord welcome. Hey, buddy. Praise the Lord. I say praise Jesus. Praise the Lord. Father, I praise you for letting me be here. I praise you for letting me be of sound mind tonight. I praise you for delivering me out of drug addiction. I praise you, Father God, for delivering me out of paranoia. My mind was gone. People told me there's no way out. You've gone too far. But Jesus, you're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the way out, and I'm here to praise your holy name. Praise you, Jesus. This is what it's all about. We don't need a rock concert. We don't need the flesh. It's a little private joke we have there. No, actually, that relates to everyone. We don't need the flesh. You don't need a move of Jeff Finholt. We need a touch of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll tell you something. I've been in the prisons, and I've had young men walk up to me and say, I've committed murder, and I'm going to be in here for life. And they don't want to hear about my platinum albums. They don't want to hear about my Rolls Royces. They don't want to hear about where I get my hair cut. They want to hear about Jesus, the Savior who sets the captive free. And that's the one we're here to praise. Hallelujah. Praise you, Holy Spirit. For thou, O Lord, O time above all the earth, thou art exalted high above, O God. For thou, O Lord, so very high above the earth. Praise you, Holy Spirit. Thou art exalted. Thank you.
Jesus, I sing my praise to you, Christ. I exalt thee, oh, my Lord, porque tú.
Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. You know, I'm going to tell you something. I know what it is to rock. I know what it is to sin. I know what it is to hang out in the world. I know what it is to be in the fast lane. And let me tell you where the fast lane's going. The exit sign says hell. I also now know what it is to praise Jesus. I know what it is to praise God. I'm not going to make any blanket statement against rock. I'm not going to do any sort of things like that tonight. But I'm going to tell you something. We need a touch of the Lord. We don't need rock and roll concerts. We don't need that. If you want to rock, there are places to rock. This is a place to praise Jesus. Holy Spirit, I pray that you direct my thoughts here. I stood on a stage Sunday night in New York City. I went into New York. I was with David Wilkerson. You people know who David is? David called and he booked me 4 months ago. And he asked if I would come to New York City to witness and share with him at a church he had called the Upper Room. Little did he know that last Sunday night, the date that was picked for me to be in New York City was to be his first night in a theater called the Mark Hellinger Theater, which is a flagship on Broadway for all the Broadway theaters. And that theater just so happens to be the very theater that I played Jesus Christ in Jesus Christ Superstar for several years. I'm telling you, I remember when I was on the picture on the cover of Time Magazine, doing Jesus and Jesus Christ Superstar. They put my picture up there, and it blew my mind because I knew I was doing drugs and drinking and all this stuff in the world. And they put my picture up, and they said, Jesus Christ Superstar rocks Broadway. And I thought, man, is that a misnomer, you know? My picture with them saying something about Jesus. But I returned to that stage last Sunday night. We saw the place packed out. As a matter of fact, they turned 2,000 people away. And I saw the papers the next day. It says, Jesus is on Broadway. Jesus, the real Jesus this time. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. I would like to do... Praise you, Jesus. I would like to do the song Messiah, if you don't mind. I know you weren't prepared for that, but I'd like to do that. How do you guys feel tonight? You got the joy of the Lord? Hallelujah. How many of you people saw me perform in the world? How many of you have seen me perform in the world? Shame on you, you people. Have you repented? Aren't I cute now? See what Jesus can do? Look at this. Hallelujah. There's people still praying for me. I have people still witnessing to me sometimes, different places. Hallelujah. I was in a mall the other day, and I was coming out of the mall. It was in California, in L.A. I came walking out, and there were a bunch of guys, and I got to tell you, they looked rugged. And it looked like a street gang. They had colors and the jackets and all the paraphernalia that goes along with it. And I saw these guys, and I saw them looking at me, and then they started following me out to the parking lot. And I thought, whoa, what's going down here? So I thought, Lord, take care of me here, you know? And I looked around. A guy comes walking up to me. He goes, hey. I said, yeah. He said, you Jeff Van Holt? I said, yeah. He goes, praise the Lord, brother. I prayed with you on Trinity Broadcast, and I got saved. He said, all my buddies here got saved, and they were going, praise God. And they had a guy there. I said, what are you doing? They said, oh, we're here in the mall. We're witnessing. And they were leading a guy to the Lord right there. Praise God. I want to do Messiah. We got that ready to go? Let's do it. Let's stand up and praise God. Praise you, Jesus.
Messiah, Prince of
And you're all invited. It's a come-as-you-are party. Jesus is throwing. And it says, heaven rejoices when one sinner repents and comes to the Lord. Man, heaven is going to be rejoicing tonight because there are going to be a lot of people turn to him. I have something I need to do quickly here before I turn it over to Paul. This is just a very personal thing, but I would hope that you people will indulge me a moment. There's a man who wrote to me from Arizona. You signed your letter. You're in a state prison in Arizona. You signed your letter, the beast in man, Joe. The people in the office lost your address, and I need you to write to me again because the Lord told me to come and see you. You've done heavy things. You committed murder. I mean, I say it, but I'm not going to go into the whole letter. And you wrote me some very heavy stuff, and I need to come and see you. I've been trying to find you, and I haven't been able to, but the Lord spoke to my heart, and I want you to write to me, care of Trinity Broadcasting Network, and we're going to come and see you because I want to tell you something. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Praise the Lord. Paul, I just turn it over to you now. Praise the Lord.
Let's say thanks to Jeff Tinholt. Time permitting, we'll have him back in a little bit. Bless you again. Thank you, brother. Love you with all our hearts. And how I praise God. He's using fine young men rescued out of Satan's clutches, going right back into that same world and preaching Jesus. Pray for Jeff. Really put him on your prayer list. Oh, how Satan hates to lose someone like that, you know? And he will bid strongly for all of us again at times. So cover Jeff with the blood, will you? And just really pray the protection of God upon him, especially as he goes back into places like New York, where there is such a tremendous need. Pray for David Wilkerson, too, who's doing a wonderful new work there in the Big Apple, as they call it. Okay, Ken and Bill Henderson, Soldiers for Jesus, are here. Let's tell these guys we're glad to see them again. They've got a little announcement to give you about some exciting things happening this week now here in the Big D. We're going to have another hallelujah, right?
We're going to do it, Paul. Amen. I would like, if you're watching by television right now, to call 5 people and invite them to come out this Saturday. We're also inviting Jan and Paul, if you guys aren't too busy, to hit the streets with us at noon Saturday. Okay. Ken's got the dates and the times. I want to share just a real quick testimony and an encouragement to the body of Christ to reevaluate your position with the Lord and see if you're living a lifestyle of evangelism. Now, my son and I were shopping in the local mall here, and a guy began to ask me questions, and I realized my antennas were going up and that he was open. He goes, what do you do? I said, well, we go all over the world and we ask people basically 3 questions. Number 1, do you believe in God? Yes. Number 2, do you believe that God sent Jesus? He died so that you don't have to? Yes. Number 3, where do you want to spend eternity, heaven or hell? Now, I said, now, hell's hot and heaven's not. Now, where would you like to go? And he goes, you know, it's funny you said that because 2 weeks ago, me and my fiance, we started searching and we're visiting churches. Now, this was the manager of this clothes store, and he, in front of all of his employees, took me by the hand and prayed and received Jesus Christ as his Savior. Amen. So, basically what we're trying to say is, Ken and I's got about a decade of practice at this, and there was a time that there was nobody to show us, but the Spirit of God has shown us a few things. If you'll come out and hit the street with us and bring some food and clothes, some great things will show up, and the kingdom of God will come to the world.
I just want to tell you where we're going to do this on Saturday, but before that, we want everyone tomorrow night to just fill these altars with food and clothing and non-perishable food and nice things that people will enjoy. I was on the streets today and downtown Dallas with all the crack dealers and the prostitutes. We saw over 40 of them give their hearts to Jesus just today. Man, God is doing a mighty move. Amen. But let me tell you real quickly, at 9 o'clock Saturday morning, we have an all-day event. But 9 o'clock, we're going to be in DeSoto at the nursing home. And that address is 1101 North Hampton Road. And then at 12 noon, you got to get there a little bit early. How many know where the Kennedy Memorial is in downtown Dallas? And the address is between Main and Commerce. Y'all know where that's at? Wave at me if you do. come out at 11:30 at that, and we're going to have us the biggest opening for Channel 58 praise celebration in the streets there. And we have about 1,500 of the Christ for the Nation students, and Living Praise is going to be there, and we hope Paul and Jan are too. And I think so. But we want you to come out and join us, and then we're going to take the food and clothes over to a place. It's Crossroads Mission at 1811 Canton in Dallas. And that's at 4 o'clock, and there's going to be hundreds of homeless out there. This is going to be an exciting time to express the Jesus in us unto Dallas and the opening of Channel 58 and His hand extended, Paul. And we're just going to have one of the greatest time of praise and worship at 12 o'clock for 1 hour straight. We're going to praise the Lord and have a time where we can boldly, something happens to you when you get out in front of traffic and high rises and you worship the Lord. How many know what I'm talking about? The same spirit that we did tonight when Jeff just sang, that type of worship we can take to the public. And you'll never be the same. You'll be so turned on for Jesus. You'll worship everywhere you go, maybe even in the stores and places. And I just want to say that that Jesus is looking for us to give 100% of ourselves. 100%. And that's what we want to do. And that's what we're saying is, you know, when we played football and we played our sports and we had our dates and all that, we gave 100% and put everything into it. Now it's time to give 100% for Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Bill. How many of you will try to bring a little something to lay at this altar tomorrow night, some canned goods, some clothing, some things that will bless hungry people? I want to tell you a little secret. You know, pastors will ask me sometimes, you know, how come God's blessing Trinity so? How come, you know, you just... if we were charting the progress, it'd just be right straight up off the graph. What's going on? How come? And you know what? It's so simple. It's so simple. To any church, any ministry, all you got to do is just simply do what He told us to do. Are you feeding the hungry? Are you clothing the naked? Are you preaching the gospel to the poor? Are you going out into the highways and byways and hedges and compelling them to come in? You know, I'll talk to pastors sometime. They say, you know, we've just been through the third split and nothing's happening and there's no glory here. And I'll say, well, where's your food pantry, huh? Where's your clothing rack? What do you mean? Well, you know, do you go out and visit people? Do you go help people? Do you go... well, we have Sunday school at 9:45 every Sunday morning, and we have church at 11, and midweek at Wednesday night, and hey, read the book. Amen. Read the instruction manual. If you want to be blessed, if you want God's blessing upon you, do what it says. He's going to ask us someday, did you feed the hungry? Did you clothe the naked? Did you visit those in prison? Did you preach the gospel to the poor? Inasmuch as you've done it unto the least of one of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. Oh, glory. Well, we're going to do that. And Dallas isn't going to be the same after this weekend and all next week. Come on. How many will at least try to join us down there for that big hallelujah Dallas? Wave at me if you'll really pray about coming. Now, come on. Don't raise your hand unless you mean it. We're going to be there as somebody... Arthur Blessed's not going to be there, is he? No, no. I tell you, we all learned a lot from that little brother, didn't we? We sure did. And we'll see you out there. Are you game, honey? Will you go with me down to... okay. Down to... it's called Dealey Square, isn't it? Down there in downtown Dallas, isn't that where you're going to meet? Oh, the Kennedy Memorial. That's different, isn't it? Good. Okay. Kennedy Memorial. Strike that. Okay. Are you ready to sing some more? Dean and Mary Brown are here tonight. How we love them, from West Memphis, Arkansas. They travel all over the country, blessing us, singing the praises of God. A lot of the scripture songs, and we especially love them. Oh, come on, a big old Dallas, Fort Worth. Welcome. How you doing, buddy? Bless you, Mary.
Power of God that made the mountains rise. Scripture song that Mary had set the music from, where is it from? St. John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And to all that believed on Him, to them gave He what?
Power.
To become
the sons.
The sons of God.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him, nothing else was made. All things were made by Him. His name was John.
He came to testify of the light.
This light was in the world that was made by Him, yet the world knew Him not.
He came unto His own, and received Him not. But to
to become the Son of God.
If somebody don't shout, I'm going to explode up here. My Lord. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, the Bible says. I don't know where we got the idea. We had to be all dignified in church and a bunch of sourpusses. No way. I'm happy to be in church tonight. I'm happy to know Jesus. I'm happy that I'm on my way to heaven. I'm happy tonight in Jesus. And I'm happy you're going to give a good offering tonight. Are you happy? You ought to get happier over that than nearly anything. Yes. Now, I'll tell you what we're going to do tonight. Those of you watching out across the network, we've been giving you little sneak previews of the beautiful new studio here on Irving Boulevard, just behind Calvary Temple here. Beautiful, beautiful new building that we will dedicate next week unto the Lord. Live, praise the Lord, is going to be coming to you. We think maybe about once a week or so. Did you know y'all have your own little baby suitcase beamer back there so that we can go live any night? Up to the satellite and bring it back down wherever in the whole country. A lot of good things go on here in Dallas. We know that. I mean, with guys like James Robison and Ken Copeland and Mike Evans and Jerry Savelle and just so many wonderful ministries here in Dallas, we'll be here a lot oftener than we were before, I promise you. Well, we're putting the final touches on that beautiful White House look-alike, and I know you're going to love it when you go in and see it next week, and we finally will show all of you out there across the network the beautiful new set and all of the inside of the new studio. Now, the good news, you know what the good news is? Channel 58 is all paid for, not a bill. Nothing other than current payables. The $3.5 million, paid. The $2 million for the transmitter, paid. The almost $1 million for the new studio, it's paid. We owe no man anything but to love one another. And I love you for that, Dallas. I really do. Now, there's a little final spit and polish. There's a little final, a few little pictures. Jan's been out buying furniture from the Penny Pincher Furniture. I kid you not. The Penny Pincher. Thank you, Penny Pincher Furniture. They have been very kind to Channel 58. I'm serious now, and have given us good discounts on the furniture that we have bought. We found another one the other day. Never Pay Retail Furniture and Accessories. Thank you, Dottie. We love you, too. They've been giving us good buys on your furnishings and the little final touches that make it so beautiful. We've done the best we can. I can stand before God and man, and I can say we have been good stewards of your money and of your facilities and of your resources. I can promise you that. And so I think it would be fitting tonight that your offering would just be that final little touch, and we'll spend every penny of it for your beautiful new studio right behind us here to put that final little crowning touch on everything. Is that a good idea? Will y'all give us a good offering to just finish that all up? And you folks out across the network, if you enjoy following the Holy Beamer to places like Dallas and all over the other parts of the country, you send in a special love gift, will you, to help keep. You made the pledges. Just send them in faithfully, and I know you will. God bless you all. Ushers, please come forward, and let's just ask the Holy Spirit now to touch and bless even as we give. Father, thank you for your precious, faithful people. Lord, they love you so much, and they have proved it again and again and again. Now, God, I ask you to bless them in a very special way. Lord, as we give to you, just let that be the key and the seed to just an abundant, overflowing blessing into their lives and into their hearts and families and businesses and churches and lives. Oh, God, we just claim it. Lord, your promise is that we will give to you, you'll give to us. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. You've said, prove me by your gifts. So, Lord, we just love you tonight, and we're enjoying your presence tonight. Touch us, lift us, and fill us with your glory, we pray, even as we give unto you. In Jesus' name, Amen. Amen. Dean and Mary are going to come back. Ushers, go right ahead. Receive our offering. Those of you at home, there will be an address on your screen in a little bit where you may send a special gift to help with these great live Praise the Lord remotes from time to time. The song says we have these treasures.
And it is from 2 Corinthians, the end of the 3rd chapter, and right on into the chapter of 4, the 4th chapter. We have treasures.
Changed into his image by the power of his word. Now we have this treasure in earthen vessels.
For God who commanded light to shine,
shine out of darkness, to shine. Persecuted and pushed down, but we are not forsaken. For this light affliction, which only lasts a moment.
Here's the good news, you ready?
Work for us eternal joy, which exceeds our sorrow. A treasure.
We have a treasure.
Greatness of his power. Now shine, 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 shine.
Shine, shine.
Shine.
Shine. The light of Jesus Christ our Lord. We have a treasure.
We have a treasure. The greatness of his power.
Are blessed by their great talent in music ministry. My goodness, we'll try to have a little, if James Robinson doesn't preach too long, we'll have a little mini concert at the end of it. But you follow the Spirit of the Lord, brother. I'm not trying to put a cramp in your style. Okay. I want you to say a great big hello to two wonderful, wonderful friends of all of you and, of course, all of us at Trinity Broadcasting. Last time I saw Dino and Cheryl, they had just returned from the great People's Republic of China. I said tonight, I said, where have you been lately? He said, Des Moines, Iowa. I said, well, praise God. Sometimes we go to faraway, strange-sounding places. Sometimes it's mid-America and places that have wonderful people that also love to be touched and ministered to with the great talent that the Lord has given him. Let's tell Dino and Cheryl Kartsanakis, we love them very much as they come to give us a great big Praise the Lord welcome. And okay, you'll introduce your bride later. All right. God bless you, Dino. clapping right now. Our Majesty, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, this is exciting. Every time I come to a TBN rally, it's not me that plays the piano. What is it? It's the Holy Spirit. And there's a tremendous atmosphere of worship here tonight. The music has been just wonderful. I've been blessed by it. How are you, honey?
I'm fine. I think he gave you an extra special dose tonight of the Spirit of God. Do you feel it?
I really do.
Yes,
well, we've got so many friends here at Dallas-Fort Worth area. Again, I'll say it this year. It's one of my favorite places to be.
Absolutely. You know, the song Majesty, Dino, just I was just watching faces out here, and you know, one of the most majestic creations of God was man. And I was looking out here, and I caught my eye was this beautiful little boy sitting on this front bench right here. And his face was just all aglow, and he was intense listening to this. And
do you play the piano? Good thing. I'd have you up here playing for sure. I was about, how old are you, about 9 years old? Well, when I was 9 years old, I was playing for congregational singing in my church, Glad Tidings Tabernacle. As a matter of fact, when we were talking about Dave Wilkerson, not too far where he is right now ministering, 33rd Street between 8th and 9th Avenues is still a church there, Glad Tidings Tabernacle. Marie Brown was our pastor. And as a matter of fact, this is the church that Brother Wilkerson came to when he first came from Pennsylvania to New York City. And that's where I first met him years ago. So that brought back a lot of memories of his ministry in New York City.
The ministers like that were pretty much instrumental in putting you where you are today, weren't
they?
So.
Yes, very much.
You know, Dino, I brought something because this child really reminded me of, and I picked this up and brought it up here.
We got that in the mail.
We got this in the mail. And so much of the time the guys talked about the young people, and we focus on a lot of different areas of life and different stages of life of human beings, but so seldom do we focus on that little child. And
really, you would be surprised the children that watch the TVN network. We get, well, my program they watch, I guess, because their mamas make them to watch. And they say, see, you can play like that someday, and the kids hate you, but they still watch, you know.
Well, I that's right. The moms come up to us a lot and say, would you please tell him? And
they'll say, tell him. Like that. And I tell them about 10 minutes a day. But anyway,
practice,
I want to kill
right? Him. Practice. But this book, where's that camera? I don't want you guys out there to miss this because this is so great. It says, it's from one of our viewers that watch the Dino show on TBN, and it says, Why I Love Dino. Now, this is drawn by one of the children. And let me open it. Where'd you go? Come here. I want you to see this. Look, Why I Love Dino. And I want you to follow, if I can read it while you do that and hold this. It says, I love you because your ring. That's kind of a thing that Dino has been noted for because lots focused on his hands. But next it says, I love you because your records. I guess Mom maybe bought a record. But next it says, you help me enjoy music class. And it has a picture here of this little girl. This is my special favorite. You help me learn about Jesus. And that's the whole point of the Dino show. And it has a picture of the Bible there. Then this one. Every time we call our dog, we think of you. Because his name is Dino, too.
And it's got black hair.
And then it's signed over here. I love you very much, from Carly. Now, Carly, we love you so much. This took time and effort and thought. And, you know, that's what we want, is to place the Word of God, the music, and all that challenges a child to become a Christian. We want to see that placed in their heart the challenge of Christ and the joy of the Lord, Dino.
And if I can be an inspiration to the children watching our program, that means so much to me, to be able to get them to perhaps take up the piano or music, but most of all, that they'll use it to honor and glorify Jesus Christ.
Right. And, you know, we were talking a while ago about the ministers that have had an impact on your life and bringing you to Christ. And last Sunday, and I'm going to insert this because it seems so right here tonight, since James Robinson is bringing the message that last Sunday where we were attending church, minister was talking about a subject, and he said, this mom, young mother, holding her one-year-old, went into a clinic. She was expecting another baby. And she began to talk to this doctor, and she said, well, the time is maybe not correct. And he said, well, maybe because of health, maybe because of, you know, the seriousness of what might happen to you if I were to go ahead and perform the surgery you need. He said, instead of performing that surgery, let me just take your one-year-old and kill it. Now that brought our hearts all right down to where it's at. Our minds all right down to where it's at. That mom had gone in to have an abortion. The time was not right to have a second baby. She just had a one-year-old. The doctor said, no, you know, it might be damaging to your health. It could cause you some difficulties. Let me just kill the one-year-old instead. She said, you murderer! How could you think of such a thing? And he said, well, honey, let's talk again. Let's reconsider. Let's find another way. Let's think about this child. Let's think about what God might want to do. The time might not be exactly right for you, but the time is right for God. And he placed this baby within you to bring it into this world to be possibly a Dino Kartsanakis, possibly a James Robison. How do we know it's not going to be a Paul or a Jan Crouch who can win the world to Christ through the gospel, through the TV ministry? Oh God, let's wake up. And let's minister to the beautiful children. And let's save our children. Let's love them. Let's protect them. Let's do what God has taught us to do as parents. And let's teach them the Word of God. Let's teach them to make a book like this, to watch TVN. And honey,
because of... forget about it, James. She's going to preach tonight. It's over.
But
let me tell you, I'm glad you said that story because it has a tremendous impact, and it's true. But because we have so many children, even right now watching this rally, I've got something just for them. You can listen in too, adults, if you want. And the name of this song, it's a medley of Sunday school songs, and I call it Kid Stuff. Hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
like that?
All you kids out there.
Say, we have got a very important birthday here tonight, and I thought this would be the time. Don, is that our man right there with the birthday?
Have several birthdays in this month of March. Jan celebrated her birthday on the 14th. My son, Paul Jr., on the 13th. Mine's is the 30th. Grandma Bethany's was the 25th. Brandon Paul Jr. is the 7th. A lot of good folks. How many were born in March? Let me see your hand. We'll sing happy birthday to all of you. Dr. Whitaker's here tonight. Stand up. He's 109 years old tonight. And he told me the other day, if he'd have known he's going to live so long, he'd have took better care of himself. Yes. Nice to have Doc Whitaker with us tonight. Come on, everybody. Happy birthday.
This is fun tonight. Why can't, who said Christians can't have fun? We should be the happiest people in the world here tonight. The joy of the Lord is in this place here this evening. That's what I like about the Friendly Broadcasting Network. I mean, you talk about variety. Well, I'll tell you, it's got it, and it's something for everyone. Children, grandparents, teenagers. But most of all ages, one cause, and that is to worship Jesus Christ. To give him all the honor and all the glory. When I was in China not too long ago, I will never forget when we visited the underground church. I will never forget as long as I live. I walked up these narrow stairs. Now, this was after a big concert in Canton at the Performing Arts Theater, which was so exciting. It was wonderful. But after the concert, Nora Lamb took us just outside of that city to this apartment. I walked in there and I saw some of the most beautiful Chinese people I ever saw, with a smile, with the glow of Jesus Christ on their face. And I noticed this little upright piano on the other side of the room. And before even Pastor Ling asked me to play, I said, "Can I play you a song?" And he said, "Oh, I'm so happy you'll do that." You know, they thought I just play grand pianos, you know. No. As a matter of fact, I wanted to play that piano. I felt such an atmosphere of worship and praise in that room. These are people who've been persecuted for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Pastor Ling, who's been put in prison, 28 years, I believe. And there he stood next to me, having found out that he's written praise choruses while he was in prison. So he was very interested in watching me play and listening. And I said, "Well, let me play you a song." And I wasn't too sure what to play because, well, I suppose I was able to play in Chinese, you know. That's what's good about being a piano player. I can play in any language. But I sat down at that broken-down piano, and I started playing this. As I was playing, there's something about that name. As I was playing it, they start to raise their hands. Little did I know that they knew that song and they've been singing it in Chinese. Jesus, Jesus. These people who've been through so much with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And here there were smiles on their face still.
praising the Lord. There's just something about that man. I'll never forget that moment. As a matter of fact, I came back to the United States and I called Bill Gaither right away. I said, Bill, do you realize that they are singing your songs in communist China? And he said, I am so pleased to hear that. Folks, let me tell you, we are so fortunate to be here in the United States of America, like tonight, to come together as Christians from all walks of life. We've got all denominations here coming together. The freedom of worshiping Jesus. There's just something about that name, Jesus. I conclude tonight before the wonderful sermon or talk, because I know it's going to be great. But you requested this over and over again, and I must play it tonight. A positive theme. We keep running that race until Jesus comes. A theme from Chariots of Fire.
when you see all this amazing talent, you wonder what in the world I'm doing here. If you haven't wondered it, I have. But this is just wonderful. No background music. Thank you very much. I think if I had some tapes like Dino, I could probably preach better. You know, some background stuff like that, that full sound. Isn't that a tremendous gift that God gave Dino? Isn't it wonderful? And then the beautiful gift that God gave to Dean and Mary Brown. Don't you like the way they sing? I love that. I don't know how many ever heard the battling banjos, but you know, they started out battling and they blend so well, it just really excited you. Their voices, and this is meant to be complimentary, not like they're in conflict, but it's like battling voices that just move in together with the same intensity and excitement that we got just listening to banjos, which seemingly would never get you there. And your voices are just fantastic. I just bless the Lord for you. And I just have enjoyed the music. I want Jeff to come and get this mic from Paul, and I want you to do something, and then I want to make a point that I think you can appreciate. Just do a brief chorus, a cappella, and sing. I mean, go ahead and sing. Don't mess around. Go on, do it. I mean, sing just a chorus and sing it for me, all right?
You want this to be a sanctified, born-again song,
belt,
obviously.
Yeah, but I want you to belt it.
He doesn't want to hear war pigs, I'm
no,
sure.
No, just do.
Okay.
Do a chorus.
Hosanna, Hosanna, in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, in the highest.
Praise you.
Amen. Now that's so easy for him. Now that's a gift. And it's a gift from God. It didn't come from the devil. But the first thing Satan seeks to do is to take what God gave and use it for his damnable purposes. Whereas God wants to use it for his redemptive purposes. Aren't you grateful God got the gift he gave? Now to go to him. God bless you. I love you, my brother. Bless the Lord for you. And Jeff wants me to take him bass fishing. He told me tonight in the hall before he came, he said, I'm really upset with you. You haven't taken me fishing. And so I'll do it. I am anointed to bass fish. And to catch them. Some of you are anointed to fish for them. I'm anointed to catch them. Oh, and to brag about it. All right, now. So you'll understand, I'm a real fisherman. It's a joy to be here. Paul and Jan, you know that I love you and appreciate you. I appreciate, as I already expressed in the welcome, I appreciate TBN, Trinity Broadcasting Network. And I don't ever want to come and speak in one of these meetings as a part of a platform of known people or gifted people. I want to come because I've been sent by God with a word from God. And I really pray that if I don't sense he's given me a word, I'll have the grace and the wisdom and the kindness to tell you I don't believe I have a word. And not bore you with me trying to say something when I didn't have anything to say. I heard Everett Stenhouse, one of the leaders within the Assemblies of God, and he's a fine man, very articulate and eloquent, much a gentleman. And he told the story about a little country church where the pastor had preached and the congregation dismissed, and they went on out to eat and they met some other folks, and one of the guys turned to another and said, well, how was the service today? He said, same old stuff. Same old sermon. Ding, dong. Ding, dong, ding, dong. And the other fellow said, oh, that's wonderful. All we ever get is ding, 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 ding. We have people who come to meetings like this one and people who come to our Bible conference and other meetings that I'm sure you've all attended, and they go away saying, I just wish our church could be like this. Well, I want to tell you, God's church is like this. I don't know what you're having wherever you meet, but this is church. And it doesn't mean everyone has to do everything the same way. It just simply means that when you really have church, the thing that makes it so exciting is the presence of God and the life of God. And what we have here tonight that's exciting you is the life of God. It's not all the talent. These people have done their thing when God wasn't there, and it was disgusting. And I preached when God's not there, and it's nauseating. I can't even stand it. I get sick. And really, it's not the flair, it's God. Because some of you say, well, these are Pentecostals, a lot of them, and they are. That's all right. It's okay for them to be Pentecostal. And you say, well, that's what it is. It's that, you know, that Pentecostal music. It's got more excitement. I've been in Pentecostal churches where God hadn't been in a while. And they got a lot of fizz, but no life. I want you to know it's not the Pentecostal, it's the power of the Spirit of Pentecost that makes a difference. And I've been in Baptist churches. I've been in Nazarene churches. I've been in Methodist churches where God's present and it's glorious. That's the difference. And God wants to fill His house and His people. A lot of you folks are worried about if you go on with God, may split your church. Well, it may, but it won't split His. You can't split God. And I just wish every heart-hungry preacher and every heart-hungry Christian would quit worrying about whether they're going to split the church. You can't split God's church. His church is one body, born in one spirit, baptized into one name. So we're one. And we may have a few people who are deceived. We may have some who are diseased. We've certainly got some who are defeated. There may even be some who are divisive. But the church of Jesus Christ is one body. And we're one. So why don't you quit fretting and fussing over it and just acknowledge the truth? It'll set you free. We're one. It doesn't matter about color or creed. We're one. Boy, I wish we'd get over this denominational stuff. And I want to make it clear, I don't have anything against denominations, and I asked God. He said He didn't either. But it's disgusting when our denominational positions come between God and the believer. Man, I have gone to all kinds of conventions. Baptist conventions where they say, we Baptists, it makes me want to barf. I asked God about it, He said He already had. I go to conventions and say, we Pentecostals, make me want to throw up. It's pulsive. Let's just be Christians. Are there any Christians in the house? Any believers in the house? That's the issue. Do we love Jesus? That's the issue. Yes, we do. And you don't have to get up. Don't. That's all right. Let me tell you. I don't want to divide this congregation over the sitters and the standers. Man, if you're more comfortable in the Spirit sitting, sit. You're more comfortable standing, stand. You're more comfortable shouting, shout. I mean, just be at peace. And don't judge each other if you have different expressions. God made the whole world.
I went to South Africa a couple of weeks ago, and it was summer. Over here, it snowed 5 inches in Dallas. I thought about staying in Africa. You go all over the United States and find many different climates. There's some people like to live in Denver. Hello, folks in Denver. There's some folks that like to live out in the smog of Los Angeles with Paul and Jay. Oh, they have a wonderful climate out there. Every now and then you see it. But it's a wonder. I like Southern California. I understand why you like it. San Diego has such a nice climate. They also have some big winds occasionally, some intense heat. You can go to Florida, and they just have such nice warm weather most of the time. They say it's a sunshine state. I've been there for 20 years. I've seen the sun down there twice. It rains a lot in Florida. They don't tell you that. You don't promote rain. But some people just love to live in Florida. We got people that wouldn't leave Louisiana, wouldn't leave Arkansas, wouldn't leave Oklahoma. And they enjoy it, but it's different. And I just wish Christians could understand that the God that made the difference appreciates it. And why can't Christians appreciate that some of us are just different in our expressions? Don't judge someone. I mean, you could go into a mainline church and there's no hands lifted. You know, there's some folks so paranoid about lifting their hands, they don't even vote anymore raising their hands. I mean, they won't vote, man. They pass a ballot. Don't worry about to see hands come in. Come up. But if they don't raise their hands, don't judge them dead. I mean, they may be dead, but I've seen people with their hands up that are dead. They look like they're under arrest, and the devil's got them. Some people are just not as expressive. Do you know some of the most Christ-like people I've known? They don't seem to smile a lot. I like to smile. I get disgusted when they don't. But God showed me there's some folks where the water runs deep that they're just not as giddy as I am. Nor as goofy. I mean, they may be a little more intellectual, a little more reserved. Don't judge them dead. One of the greatest, most anointed men I ever heard in my life was a professor from a Southern Baptist school in the Carolinas named Dr. Charles Howard. They didn't even discover Charles Howard among Baptists until he was nearly dead. The man paid the way, full college, out of his meager paycheck of more than 300 students when I met him. Charlie Howard preached in the Dallas Memorial Auditorium. W.A. Criswell preached in that conference. I was only 19. Billy Graham closed the Tuesday night meeting. But on Monday night, when W.A. Criswell had preached on "Do It Again, Lord," what you did with Finney, what you did with Moody, what you did at Pentecost, do it again, God. Dr. Criswell, he's doing it again. Praise God. What Dr. Criswell preached for, he's doing. But that night when Dr. Criswell gave the invitation, many thousands came and knelt and said, God, do it in me. F.B. Meyer was a man who wanted the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and he walked outside his home place and said, God, I don't know what it is, I don't know what you call it, but oh God, I need it. And Criswell said, do it again, do it again. And Billy Graham made his way down, many didn't even know he was there, made his way down cement steps in the Memorial Auditorium, made his way to an entrance to the lower floor that was jammed with preachers praying, and Billy knelt. A friend of mine at a small Baptist church was kneeling nearby, and he heard this man saying, almost in a broken tone, oh God, use me, God, use me, God. And he just looked back, and it was Billy Graham. What humility. God, use me. In that same meeting, Charlie Howard would get up and seldom raise his voice. It was almost like a whisper. But you were bathed in love, bathed in compassion, because he was filled with love for everyone. He said, you ask, do I witness to everyone? Dr. Howard, do you witness to everyone? He says, no, but I ask God If he wants me to witness to everyone. He said, I walked through a lobby of a hotel the other day, and I saw a soldier with his country's uniform. And I walked over to him and said, young man, you fought for our country. Bless you. You would have died for this country if necessary. Did you know Jesus died for you? And he said, that soldier in that lobby cleared his throat and spit in my face. And he said, the spittum struck me on the cheek, ran down toward my lips. He said, I instinctively reached for my handkerchief, raised it to wipe away the spittum, when the Holy Spirit caused me to pause, and I reflected. Jesus never got to do that. He hung on the cross with spikes through quivering hands, with the filthy spittum of unholy men's mouths mingled in his beard. He never got to wipe it away. He said, as I did wipe it away, I thought, Lord, what love. I got on the elevator. The doors closed. A man said, where can I get a drink? Dr. Howard said, up on the 10th floor in my room, you can get a drink. And he said, what have you got to drink? He said, a pitcher of ice cold water. And the man said, I don't need any blinkety blank water. I don't want that. Dr. Howard said, yes, you do. You need water. You need the water of life. And out of your innermost being can flow rivers of living water. And the doors opened on the man's floor. He pushed Dr. Howard out of the way and said, move, you old man. And as he stepped out into the hallway, he looked back on the elevator and let fly the fiercest profanity, obscenities. And the doors closed, and the tears coursed down Dr. Howard's cheeks. And the elevator operator, at that time operating the elevators in those old days, looked at Dr. Howard and said, sir, that man shouldn't have done that to you. That was most unkind. He shouldn't have done it. Dr. Howard said, oh, that's all right. And the boy said, no, sir, it's not all right. He shouldn't have done that. He said, it's okay, son. And he said, but listen, on the 10th floor, with the elevator turned off, down on his knees in the elevator, he drank deeply of the water of life. Dr. Howard said, I don't ask all of them about Jesus, but I ask Jesus about all of them. And I do what he says. Now, here's a man who had a different approach. Why so calm and so quiet was Dr. Howard that a basically reserved and a denomination of biblical integrity had almost overlooked this gem, this priceless treasure? Why, in Pentecostal circles, it's unlikely he would have been asked to lead a silent prayer, much less to speak. If you're not careful, you'll judge people by the outer expressions and miss the real key. It is the Spirit that gives life, and it's the Spirit of Christ. And don't ever judge a congregation by the outward response. Just see, is Jesus here? I have an idea some of you could point to some of the most sacred times you've ever experienced when it was absolute quiet, except for some weeping, perhaps, maybe some brokenness, but just quietness. I hope you understand what I'm saying. I'm really seeking to be used as an instrument of God to teach the body of Christ to have appreciation for the variety and the distinctiveness and the differences within the body and the parts. Can't you do that? And what is it we look for? The life of God. And can I tell you that when you have an attitude of love toward one another, you're going to have that life. You're going to have that presence. And we have it here tonight. And really, it's not the gifts. It's the fact we love each other. These people up here love me. Jeff Finholt loves me. I can't stand his hair. I mean, he needs a haircut in the worst way of anybody I've known in my life. And I know a lot of you thought that. Baptists would faint if he walked in. Jerry Falwell would have cardiac arrest. He'd have a stroke. But this boy can sing. And I want to tell you something, and I'm not fussing with you. But if his hair kept you from hearing Jesus, he hadn't got the problem. You do. See? I already told you, I don't like his hair. But it didn't bother me. Do you understand that? See, what I'm trying to tell you is, it's not bothering him for me to tell him. He ain't going to the barber when he leaves here tonight. If God told him to, he would, but don't you ever cut your hair because a bunch of us stiff-necked preachers try to get him to cut his hair. Cut it when God told him to cut it. What's a Pentecostal evangelist? What I just thought of it. Wears all the big rings and watches Brian Rudd, right? I asked Brian Rudd. I don't know how Brian's doing. I pray for Brian a lot. If you're in trouble, Brian, come see me. I'll try to help you. I don't know how you do it. I haven't heard about you in a while. Maybe in jail. I don't know. A lot of preachers end up in jail. Probably not near as many as belong in jail, but a lot of them end up in jail. But old Brian Rudd, he got these big diamonds, big watches, man, he can't raise his hand. He got on so much jewelry. And I said, what's the deal with this guy, all this stuff? Man, I didn't ask Brian. I mean, I'm eating with him, you know. I have to help him drink his stuff. He's got so many bracelets already. He couldn't drink. My goodness, he's got big rings. Well, man, all of a sudden, he just blurted out. He said, you know why I wear all this stuff? I said, man, I was dying to know. Maybe I'm going to get a break here. He said, man, I came off the street with a bunch of thugs, a bunch of pimps, a bunch of junkies. He said, all of them think you got to be a thug to have anything nice. He said, I go down on the street and say, look at all this stuff. God gave it to me. Jesus changed my life. But I want to tell you, it's not the fact that people in the body of Christ are different that's quenching the spirit. It's the fact that so many people who are Christians are so stinking critical. We don't give a person a chance for God to work through. Man, I didn't even know Dino had a suit that wasn't white till tonight. Man, I nearly fainted. But, I mean, you write folks off. I mean, he's got some of them that glisten, you know. Don't write people off just because of the packaging. Do you know that's one reason why so few people get healed? Because a lot of the packaging for healing is sort of distracting, and it really hinders sometimes. But what happened is we made celebrities out of the healers. There were so few people who would ever pray for sick people. When a few did, well, lo and behold, some folks got well. It wasn't really as hard as we thought it was. They went for it. Well, then people get pumped. And when people get pumped, a lot of them stop praying. And pumping people start pumping flesh. And pretty soon the guy on the stage, if God's not there, he's got to act like God's there. And when there's no power to shake, he's going to shake anyway. He'll carry a hand warmer in his pocket just to get a hot hand. Don't tell me, I know. But it's because we press that on people. We got to look for Jesus, see, and get past all this stuff. Man, that's where John Wimber was so cool, you know? Come out in a little old sweater, no tie, beard. He just calm. Man, you think he must be sick. He's moving so slow. But he'd just move over and pray for him, and he'd hit the deck. He didn't hit him in the head. He just sort of looked at them, boom, down they go. And he just calm and laid back and smiling. See, what he's showing you is it's not the style, it's Jesus. Man, I want to have Jesus. See, I'm so free to move about in all different circles. I didn't have to worry about somebody getting me in the background with this long-haired kid singing anymore. I would have gotten 25 cancellations. 8 years ago, just to be seen on the platform. But man, I'd have got kicked in the teeth for being with Paul and Jan. Oh, Lord. And well, what are you doing with them? I mean, I'm serious with you. People are critical. They're mean. And some of your crowd's mean. Paul, they don't even like you. I talked to Pentecostals. They can't stand you. A lot of them told me they like you. I mean, really, last time I was with Paul, I had to minister to him. He's wanting to kill somebody. He's so mad. He was. He's praying, God, kill him. If you don't, I think I will. I mean, Paul was hacked. He got mad at me for not understanding why he was hacked. The folks get mad in all these different circles. But see, listen to me now. I'm trying to help you. I'm free to move in any circle. Because I'm not trying to take care of my reputation. I mean, mine's shot, and I didn't even fall in some horrible crime. All I did is follow God. My reputation went kaput. But boy, if you get rid of that reputation, you can just get out and see Jesus. And I've been in all these different churches. Man, I've been in the different denominations. And Jesus is so real in so many of his people. And he wants to be real everywhere. Well, I hadn't got to my sermon yet. I've just been having fun. I want you to open your Bible. Paul, if you want a short sermon, don't ask me to come. I don't have a short sermon. I don't. I'm sorry. I mean, you know, you own the network. Why are you worrying about time? I'm glad we got one TV show where you don't have to have a commercial break. We just nonstop. This sermon won't be interrupted tonight by a beer break, beer commercial, or soap suds. We just run straight through with Jesus. Now, I want to say something to the television audience. Now, I don't know whether you're having fun or not. Some of you are still worrying about Jeff's hair. But now, listen to me. Some of you are trying to figure out what I'm doing here. I'm here to help you. God sent me, and he's got you watching. I'm going to promise you something. If you'll stay plugged in, keep your seatbelt buckled, I pray if you reach for that dial, God will paralyze your hand. I'm not being unkind to you. I'm trying to help you because your spirit's already paralyzed. I mean, you're a wreck. I mean, you may think you're a big shot and you're looking in to criticize all us religious kooks, but friend, you're so freaked out, so messed up, that your life's not worth a plug nickel. You're even thinking about ending it. You can't get drunk enough to be happy. You can't get enough pills to get happy. You haven't made enough money to get happy. You haven't met enough people to get happy. And God's got you watching tonight. You haven't joined enough churches to make you happy. You haven't got enough memberships to get you happy. I want you to stay plugged in. Because I'm going to promise you, if you've got one sane fiber in your being, you're going to be saying praise God before you even get saved. Because you're going to like what you hear, and if you'll stay plugged in, you're going to meet the reason for all this joy, and his name is Jesus. So don't you leave. Remember now, I don't want something to happen to you reaching for that dial. You stay tuned in. I want you to open your Bible to the third chapter of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 3. We're having a wonderful time already. I'd move my membership tonight if somebody would invite me. I like this. Thank you. Jan said she liked me. I believe that. We have a good time. Now, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1. Are you there? Now, I always read, normally read out of the New American Standard Version, there's a little difference in the two. Some churches split over that. So I read the King James. Good enough for Paul and Peter, it's good enough for me. Can I just tell you, if that's where you are, that's dumb. I mean, not even educated. You're not smart. Whew. Man. I mean, I got a preacher friend that got up and preached. He didn't know anything. I mean, he knew nothing about the Bible. He preached out of the book of Job. Preached from palms. Preached on Noah in the lion's den. Had eight saved. Some of you are sitting out here saying, oh, it wasn't Noah in the lion's den. I know it. It was Moses. But some folks are just touchy all the time. I'm reading from the New American Standard, if you'll forgive me, all right? And if you read your King James, it says, forgive me, while I read out of the New American Standard. Amen. Now, some of you don't understand what I'm talking about, but church folks are plumb silly. They're mean, boy. I mean, they are. They're mean. But Jesus' crowd are different. See, when I use the term church sometimes, I'm not talking about the world's church. I'm talking about the real church. It's a vast difference. Here we go. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of the Gentiles, he had quite a reputation. He went from one jail to the other. Most preachers make pulpits famous. He made prisons famous. Which jail are you preaching in next, Paul? How would you like to have an evangelist that's coming as soon as he gets out of jail? We may have some of them like that soon, you know? You're friendly, aren't you? Don't sneak up behind me now unless you're friendly. If indeed you've heard of the stewardship of God's grace, which was given to me for you, that by revelation, this means God's talking to him. Now, don't take offense at this. God wants to talk to you. If you just want to read the Bible all the time and think that's all there is to it, that's really an insult to God. It'd be an insult to your wife. I mean, really, my wife's got a shoebox full of my love letters that I wrote her in college, and I'm glad she'll take them out and read them every now and then. But the first time she takes that box to bed, we're going to have trouble. I want her to appreciate the letters, but she can't love those letters. You can appreciate the letter, but you got to love God. He wants to talk to you. He wants fellowship with the saints. Man, he didn't just give you a book and say, see you later. He said, I gave you a book so you can know me. Fellowship with me. Commune with me. Well, by revelation, there was made known to me, Paul says, the mystery. He says, you know, I've got all the Old Testament scriptures. I know the Old Testament. I've got it. But God revealed a mystery that all you Bible thumpers and all you Bible readers never saw. And there's so much hidden in the written word that we've never seen because we've got our systematic approach to theological truth and we miss the whole truth, and you can see the death effect that intellectualism and scrutiny of the scriptures without the impartation and the illumination of the Holy Spirit. You can see what it does. It's death. God wants to show us the hidden truths in the Word. He didn't just tell us the story of Israel. I love Israel. I love the nation. But I got to tell you something. He took Israel not just to make a covenant with, but to show Israel how he wanted to make a covenant with everyone. He wanted to show us how we could relate to him. And I got news for you. He made promises to the nation Israel. But you got to hear this. There won't be one of them fulfilled, not one blessing on Israel or any member of that nation outside a relationship with Christ. Period. You have to get in Christ to receive what God has. And God wants to save Israel. And God wants to save Arabia. And God wants to save Khomeini. Pray for that guy. He's not too big for God. He can get saved. Pray for Gaddafi. Pray for Fidel Castro. Pray. I'm serious. I'm not just blowing smoke. Pray for him. God, save Gaddafi. Save Khomeini. Man, why can't we witness to these people? You got to love them. Man, we shouldn't have been over there courting the Shah of Iran just so we could pad our pockets while there were atrocities that compared to some of the Nazi atrocities. No wonder they rebel. No wonder they can give us such a black mark. No wonder the people across the border have such a low opinion of Americans. We're whoremongers and drunkards and bargain seekers in the eyes of so many people. There was a time when the American people were known for righteousness and goodness and freedom. Now we're known as capitalists and selfish and AIDS and homosexuality and abortion and slothfulness. That's what we're known for in much of the world. The only people that respect us in the world now are those who look up to the fact that we had some measure of success. They don't even understand freedom anymore. These people in our nation have so abused freedom. It's got to change. I'm really convinced that the greatest diplomacy the world will ever know has got to take place at the hand of the church, the missionaries. That's where we've got to do the job. That's the answer. What did MacArthur say when he left Japan? Send missionaries. We taught them how to make stuff. Now they're going to buy us. We should have taught them how to know God. They were a crushed and devastated people. I don't know how egotistical MacArthur was, but when he said send missionaries, he said the truth. That's what we should have done. But we were too busy rejoicing in the spoils of victory. Now they're going to buy us. They couldn't beat us with kamikazes, but they may buy the whole place. Listen, why can't we just humble ourselves before God and not wait for somebody to drop a bomb on us? And you can't build a strong enough defense system to secure us. Terrorists will blow up everything in your town. You can't control a terrorist. You say, what do you do about terrorism? Get the shields of God to protect the people of God. It's the only hope America's got. What do you do about the terrorists? Let's win them to the Lord. Everybody's a potential terrorist outside Jesus. Mothers and daddies are killing each other. Mothers and daddies are killing their kids. Kids are killing parents. Everybody outside Christ is a potential terrorist. God wants us to take the gospel of Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth. And he wants us to do it as Paul did, from a point of fellowship and knowledge of the scriptures that was given to us by revelation. And let me tell you how you know when you get it from God. It produces God-likeness, Christ-likeness. It produces the life of Jesus, not a bunch of religious, unkind, critical, hostile, divisive, mean people. It produces Jesus. Look what he says. Here we go. Here's a mystery. God wants to show us some things. As I wrote before in brief, and by referring to this, when you read, you can understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. I've got an insight into the mystery of Christ. What is it? Which in other generations was not made known. This mystery was not made known in previous times to the sons of men. Even the prophets didn't understand what they were prophesying. Peter said the prophets knew that what they said could only be fulfilled later in us. They didn't even comprehend. You know what some of the prophets knew, Peter said? They knew that they did not prophesy concerning their own day, but our day. They knew it wouldn't even happen in their time, and yet they didn't comprehend what they were saying. And the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Levites, the scribes, the scholars, the lawyers, all of these people did not understand what God revealed to Paul. Look at this. He's got an insight. In other generations, it was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles, to those people who saw Jesus, and to the prophets in the Spirit, those people to whom the Spirit communicated truth. Now he's going to get specific. Look at verse 6. To be specific, this is the mystery. This has been hidden. That the Gentiles, the non-Jewish community, those not of Israel, are fellow heirs, and fellow members of the body, and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Can anybody get excited about that at all? Do you understand what he's saying? He said, this great God that delivered the people, that parted the waters, this great God that provided for his people, that fed his people, that drove out the enemies, this great God is the God of everyone through Christ. And that's the gospel. You can know God. You can be an heir of God in Christ. So the first mystery he touches on here is that salvation's for everybody. Now, I just came from South Africa. They've got a problem with apartheid. The United States position toward them is not a sane, safe, wise position. It has been manipulated by those with political self-interest and those who don't really understand the situation. And we're putting political pressure on a people who right now need our prayers as much as any people on earth. I'll tell you something. If we'll pray for people in South Africa, they're not angry with blacks. As a matter of fact, I saw more animosity, black toward white, black toward black, and white toward black in 30 minutes walking through the airport in New York City riding on a shuttle bus in New York City than I saw in 8 days, 24 hours a day in South Africa. I saw more meanness, more hostility, and we got civil rights. And we got black folks that are still on a rampage because somebody did their forefathers and them dirty. Now, I want to say something to the black community, and I want you to hear me. I understand you've been hurt, but if you don't get healed of your hurt, you can't help heal the situation. No hurt preacher, no hurt black politician, Jesse Jackson included, is ever going to help heal the wounds of a severed nation. You have got to get over the hurt and the mistreatment. I agree the white man mistreated the black man. It was wrong what whites did. It was an abomination. But the gospel of Jesus Christ frees us not only of the atrocity, but the bitterness that results from it. And that's the only hope for the healing of the races. And we need it in America. We not only need civil rights, we need spiritual liberty. Freedom in Christ to love one another. I have no problem loving people of any color, any race. I can't understand anybody having that problem. I love everybody. Doesn't matter what color they are. I can't even see the distinction of color. Man, I agree black's beautiful. I think it is beautiful, but so is white, and so is red, and so is yellow. And brother, I'm so sick and tired of black power and black policy and black interests. How about just having interest in people, period, and stop all this nonsense? That's what the gospel says. And brother, any preacher, any denomination, any church that says, well, we're not going to have blacks, we don't want them, you're not a Christian church. You don't have a spirit of Christ. And 1 John says, if you don't love your brother whom you can see, you don't even know God. So I don't care how big your Bible is. I don't care how big your crowd is. If you have trouble loving somebody for any reason. I'm so sick of the hypocrisy among, quote, church folks. Some folks say, well, we love blacks, but you don't like charismatics. You would more quickly accept and minister to someone with AIDS than you would a charismatic. I'm sick of this labeling business. I'm sick of all this division. So is God. I mean the dissension between the people of God. You're a hypocrite if you say, we love blacks, but somebody in your church has an experience you may not understand and you're mean to them. You're not right with God. And then those of you that have the experiences and you think you're better than everybody else. You're not being controlled by the Holy Spirit you claim to have. You may have Him, but He's trying to get you. That's your problem. He wants you so He can love through you, not intimidate people and manipulate people and pressure people. Let's just be so Jesus-like and Christ-like that people want to know, what must I do to be saved like you? What must I do to be free like you? And it's not a theological argument. Folks, we're talking about a Jesus that knows no distinction between races. That's no respecter of persons. Folks, if He rent the veil, that meant nothing will keep you from God. And I'm going to tell you something else. He tore down the wall, the dividing place. There is no division in God's eyes. So let's not have it anymore, okay? And it doesn't mean you won't be black. Doesn't mean you won't be white. Doesn't mean you won't be Baptist. Doesn't mean you won't be Pentecostal. Let's just recognize truth. We are one. Like it or not, we're one. So learn to like it because it's the truth. Learn to love people. And I challenge you from the bottom of my heart, Christians in America, leaders in America, pray for the people of South Africa. They developed their own culture. They went in and got the gold. They used the port. They set up their own white government. They didn't take the native people of Africa and say, come over here and obey our laws and vote with us. They left them in their tribes. They left them with their people. And they were warring with one another. Now they're civilized. And they're working in the white communities. And they're not being treated as fairly and squarely as they need to be. But are you going to, in one election, because Jesse Jackson or anybody else says, vote now, or don't you ever go to work? And you know what the terrorists are saying to the black man that wants to go to work? While you're at work, we're going to kill your kids. And they do kill their kids a lot of times. And then they cut a tire in half, and they call it necklacing. And they put the tire around their neck, and they pour gasoline in the neck. This is on black people, not white people. This is black people to black people. and they put the necklace around them. They put the gasoline in the tire, and they throw a match at it while they have their hands and feet bound, and they burn in the streets with a ring of fire. And Mrs. Mandela said in a speech, "With our matches and our necklaces, we will change Africa." Is that how Martin Luther King would have said do it? You know what Martin Luther King's advisor said and counsel said when I was in South Africa 2 weeks ago? He called a press conference. He said, "This man has preached the answer for South Africa. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not a political answer. It's Jesus Christ." That's what the former mayor of Soweto said. And he'll say it on our TV program in just a few weeks. In the midst of Soweto with 8 black tribes all around 1.5 million population. The gospel's the answer. You don't just suddenly demand vote this way, vote that way. Give them a chance to make the transition. Who are we to impose our ways on everybody else and say march to the same rhythm we demand? South African people love God, Paul. I pray you get the station. I tried to do a little groundwork to help make it come to pass while I was there. They need it. They want it. They're just begging for the gospel of Jesus Christ to be preached on their stations over there. They don't have anything, but they love God, and they love the blacks, and the blacks love the whites, and somebody's trying to stir them up. Let's pray for them. Wouldn't it be wonderful if South Africa would have such a spiritual awakening that they could be an example to the rest of the world how to deal with racial tension? I promise you the political activists won't solve it. It's going to take Jesus. Are you hearing? The gospel of Jesus Christ is for the Gentile. And I want to show you a second mystery here. And you're going to appreciate this because this is going to apply to you. Those of you who are watching by television, many of you have never met Christ. I want you to know Jesus died for you. Regardless of your background, regardless of your sin, you can't commit a sin too great for Jesus. A man walked down an aisle in a Chicago mission and fell down on his knees, but with no tears. The minister walked over to him. The man looked up and said, "I'm too great a sinner. God can't save me." You know what that man had done a few weeks before under the influence of alcohol because he was a horrible alcoholic? His little girl had died, age 3 or 4. That alcoholic man had walked to the casket of his little daughter, and from her lifeless body, he took her little shoes and put her shoes in his pocket, and after the funeral, went out and sold the shoes and bought some more whiskey. That man said, "I'm too great a sinner." And the preacher said, "There's no sin too great for Jesus. He'll forgive you." And that man got saved. His name was Mel Trotter. He became one of the greatest mission workers the world has ever known. He was born again. He said, "I'm too great a sinner. There's not anything you can do that's too big for God. The blood of Jesus Christ covers all our sins. He wants to forgive you." Man, there's so many people that are going through regret and remorse and oppression right now. You feel there's no hope. There are people, listen to me right now, that think they'd like to end it all. Listen, I've been there. I know what it is. I had no home. I had no family. I had no chance. And then Jesus came into my life. And Jesus changed my life. That's not the end of the battle. The battle's continuing. We're going to talk about that right here and what you do. But I want to tell you, Jesus is the answer. Now listen closely. There's a second mystery here. I am convinced. As important as the first mystery is, we can't deal properly with the unsaved world. We can't preach the gospel of the kingdom. You know what the kingdom means? Don't get hung on that. Say kingdom now, dominion. Quit that stuff. Oh, goodness, it must make everybody tired. Why do we take sacred terms and make people afraid of them? Listen, the gospel of the kingdom is simply this. The rule of God in the heart of the believer. God on the throne of your individual life. Not God sitting on the throne in Washington or any other man in the name of God sitting in the White House saying, "This is dominion." Baloney. Listen to me. We may have a Christian president. We may have a heathen president. God can use the heathen to bless everybody. Man, we can pray. Hey, that's the issue, is get the church right. Let the kingdom of God prevail, not take over with riot squads, numbers and majorities and weapons and kick everybody out. That's not the issue. The issue is to let Jesus so rule in your heart and so reign in your heart that everything you touch is affected by the life and love of God. That's kingdom life. Jesus ruling in me. I can take this Bible and show you that Paul and the New Testament apostles and Jesus never dealt with the issue of slavery. I believe slavery is an abomination. Now get this straight, you touchy folks. I believe slavery is wrong. But the Bible didn't deal with the issue of slavery. As a matter of fact, Jesus taught, and Paul specifically, on at least four occasions taught, if you're a slave, be the most Christ-like slave on the face of this earth. And if you're a slave owner, be the kindest, gentlest person that ever lived and treat those slaves like part of the family. Now, we don't have slavery, but everybody in America is becoming a slave. A slave to a system, a slave to the pressures that are on us, a slave to our economy, and a slave to the social programs that we enacted to take care of the slaves that were freed. See, and take care of people that can't do certain things. We're all slaves because the issue is an issue of heart, not just legislation. It's the heart. I got news for you. This whole country may become a prisoner. But if Jesus is in our heart, you can't put me in prison. I'm a free man. You can't build a big enough jail cell to take away the peace that runs like a river in my heart. You can't do it. You can't heat the fire hot enough that the fourth man's not able to walk with me in. Man, would you please get excited about who He is in us and who we are in Him? And you'll have kingdom life. So we've got to preach the gospel of the rule of God in the life of the individual. Now watch this. And we're going to move to a conclusion that I think can be liberating to those of you who will hear me out. Listen to the word of God, please. To be specific, he said the Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body, fellow partakers of the promise of Christ through the gospel, of which I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me according to the working of His power. Now look what Paul says. To me, look at the humility, the very least of all the saints, this grace was given, this understanding, this commission, to do what? To preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ. And to watch this, here's the second mystery. Oh, please hear this, church. Church in America, believer in America, please hear this. And to bring to light what is the administration or the working of the mystery. Here's another mystery, which for the ages has been hidden in God. This too has been hidden, just like the Gentiles and the truth concerning the gospel to them. It's been hidden in God who created all things in order, watch, that the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known through the church. To who? To the political leaders in Washington? To the powers in Rome? To the emperor? Who to? Are you looking in your Bible? To whom? To the rulers and authorities in heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose which He carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord. Listen to what He carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Colossians chapter 2, beginning at verse 13, listen closely. And when you were dead in transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with Him, having forgiven us of all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt, dealing with our sins, consisting of decrees against us, and which was hostile to us, and He has taken it out of the way, and He nailed it to the cross. He dealt with your sins. But look what else He dealt with. And when He, Jesus, disarmed the rulers and authorities, He did not disarm Herod, He did not disarm Pilate, He did not disarm the emperor, He did not disarm Rome. Who did Jesus Christ disarm? He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public display of them, having triumphed over them through Him, Christ. What did He do? He overcame death. He overcame the grave. He overcame the power of sin. He overcame the power of Satan. He did not destroy Satan. He disarmed him. He made him ineffective. He made it possible for you to escape his grasp. You picture it like this. Satan puts a grip on the enemy, on the people of God. He takes them captive. He puts a yoke of slavery on them, a yoke of bondage, a yoke of oppression, and he begins to lead them with chains. They're in prison. They're enslaved. Jesus said, I came to set the captives free. Satan has his grip on the unbeliever. The God of this world blinds the eyes of the unbelieving. The God of this world has snared them with the cords of their own iniquity. He holds them captive in the yoke of sin and slavery. Can you see that? Now listen to me. Every unsaved person right now is controlled by the devil. I don't care how sophisticated you are. I don't care if you go to church and you're very suave and debonair. You may not like the word demon-possessed. It's a strong word. Demon-possessed means that you have absolutely no control. And not everyone is demon-possessed, but every unbeliever is demon-controlled and demon-infested and satanically owned. You're a child of wrath. And the enemy's in control of your life. And he will destroy your life and destroy your soul. And he can give you a lot of class. He can make you rich. He can make you look smart. He said he will. He said, I can give you all these things. He told that to Jesus. He said, I'll give you power. The devil is a power broker. He deals this way. And he uses force. But he's controlling your life. He's going to destroy you. Now, Jesus Christ came to break the power of the enemy and to set captives free and to save every unsaved person so that you could then walk in the fullness of life, in new life in Christ. That's the gospel. He did it. He broke the power of the enemy. He didn't destroy the enemy. He's still here. But he broke his effectiveness. Pow, like that. So that you can be free to move in the flow and the fullness of the Spirit of the living God and life. But, please see this, the enemy is still here. The devil has not yet been chained. The devil has not yet been bound. The devil has not yet been destroyed. He's still here. His works have been destroyed. He's been rendered ineffective. But if you're not covered with the glory of his presence, if the house is not occupied, what did Jesus say would happen to a house that a demon is cast out of? Let me ask you something. If the scripture says that deliverance by man is in vain, that means man can't cast out demons apart from God. It's got to be God, right? So if God delivers, and he's the only one who can, and the demon goes out, and Jesus says, if the house swept clean, only one can clean it up is God. If it's swept clean, set in order, the demon's cast out, only God can do it. But if the house is not occupied, filled, then the evil spirit that went out comes back to the house he left and says, and don't get an argument of is this demon going to get in or on the outside. If a guy's got a gun in your ribs, or if he's sitting across the room with a high-powered rifle pointing at you, it doesn't matter whether he's over there or over here, he's got you. So don't get in the fruitless discussion of where he is. It's not where he is that counts. It's what he's doing that troubles God. He's got you in prison. He's got the gun on you. He's controlling you. Now, please hear this. That's what the devil seeks to do to every believer. Once the enemy's driven out, we don't get the house occupied. He comes back, and what does he say? He brings seven more with him. And the second condition is worse than the first. Let me tell you something. Every Christian listening to me tonight that got freed by God, saved by God, and did not walk in the Spirit, being filled to overflowing with the Spirit, and walk in obedience to God and dependence on God, every believer sitting here tonight and listening to me on television is more tormented this moment. If you're not living in freedom and fullness, you're more tormented tonight than you were before you made your decision for Jesus Christ. You're miserable. And you know what you have to do? You have to fake it. You have to say everything's all right and everything's not all right. You have to smile when you know you're not smiling inside. You have to look like you're worshiping. Look like you're right with God. When inside, you know you're not. You've been taken over by the enemy. Now listen closely. In the Old Testament book of Judges, there was a cycle that occurred. It used to trouble me when I read it. Only today I feel like God showed it to me. It says that the people turned away from God after being right with God, went into sin and got in prison and God sent deliverers, and they were delivered. And then peace would be in the land for 40 years, or for 50 or 60. And then they'd get back in sin. And then he'd send another deliverer. And then they'd get right. And then it says, and peace was in the land. And it uses this word, and quiet was in the land. Now please hear me. The Old Testament was written to teach us not just about historical Israel. Oh, Lord. Thank God for what it's taught us about historical Israel. But it was written as instruction for us. It happened to them as an example for us. Now, the same cycles occur in the life of the believer. There's quiet in the land. Let me tell you what's troubling me somewhat tonight. I know some of you are tired. Me too, okay? I'm weird. Some of you, Pete's already gone to sleep. Good night, Pete. Now, it's all right. Listen to me. It's past his bedtime. Nine's his bedtime. He's been asleep 20 minutes. But now listen to me. Some of you are really weary. But I watched you earlier. And you were weary earlier. And you laughed when I was going. But there's heaviness coming on you now. You want to know why? You say, I'm tired, boy. Worked hard, son. I'm not a preacher. Don't just work one day a week like you. Work every day, son. Tired. No. There's a spirit ministering to you to distract you from the liberty that can be yours in Christ. I'm not scolding you if you're tired. I mean, really, God will set you free in your sleep if you just keep your spirit right, okay? Don't let the enemy cut you off right now. I'm trying to help you. Here's what troubled me earlier. I looked at you folks, and you're so pretty. You've got to be some of the sweetest people in the world to come here tonight and love each other like you do. But did you know I looked at a lot of you, and there's no quiet in the land? And you know, I think those of you who've been in the world, Jeff, you understand torment, don't you, buddy? You understand traffic. Johnny Cash is the first person to ever talk to me about demons. Johnny Cash. He said, buddy, I know about demons. He started telling me the names of demons that he met in prison while he was on drugs. And buddy, I never heard anybody talk about that. Johnny Cash said, you can see spirits on people. He began to tell me. But see, there was torment. People who understand the real world. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 that the real world is not the temporal which you can see, but it's the unseen. That's the real world. Now, I want you to learn something about that world tonight. I've looked at people since I got on this platform who have no quiet in your land. You don't ever have quiet. I have a daughter that's one of the most beautiful girls in the world, and most of you love her and would look up to her almost with an admiration that just defies imagination. Her name is Rhonda. Sweet girl. I've watched that beautiful girl weep with me and Betty for extended periods of time saying, stand the noise. Let me have a microphone, Paul. This one's dying on me. I can't stand the noise. I understand what she was talking about. Go to this mic. She said, it's noisy. Now, this is a girl that's at the most beautiful home. And to me, I see Jesus in her as much as anybody. But the devil tells her, Jesus is not in you. The devil says, people don't see Jesus in you, Rhonda. I've got a letter in my briefcase I brought home today and left a copy. I said, give it to Rhonda. It was the sweetest letter a lady wrote who understands music and said, you know, Jeannie Rogers is gifted. Referred to some of the great musicians we had in our Bible conference. Oh, they're all so great. But the lady said, you know what I like? I like Rhonda. That quiet Jesus. I see Jesus. But the devil tells Rhonda it's not so. It's all this noise. Not quiet. And I hear my little daughter say, I want it to be quiet. I understand. But see, I've looked at some of you tonight. You haven't had quiet. Now listen to me. I've experienced quiet peace in the land. I'm experiencing it right now. Last fall, I had a dark night of the soul. But God was changing me some more. I was going through a baptism of fire. I'm not sure the baptism of fire, even theologically, if you'll trace it out, is not the baptism of the work of the tempter and the assaulter and the accuser against the believer. I'm not sure that's not the baptism of fire. Now, Holy Ghost fire is true, too. But I believe the real baptism of fire is what Peter went through when Satan demanded permission to sift him. David Wilkerson's current message on the sifting of the saints is powerful. God bless you, David. It's wonderful. And that's exactly what happens. When you cross the line of obedience, as David Wilkerson said, the devil demands permission to sift you, and God gives him permission. And brother, I'm going to tell you, it's a baptism of fire. And let me tell you, you'll never make it through that baptism if you're cocky and arrogant. If you think you're it, you will never make it through that baptism. You'll never make it. Peter did make it. By grace, he said, I've sinned. Mr. Big Shot, Mr. Great, the guy that said, I leave all to follow you, Jesus. If nobody else goes, I'm going. Everybody else may turn back, not me. He said, Peter, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows. Satan demanded permission to sift you. And he said, after you've gone through it, what did he say? Isn't this incredible? Well, I pray you'll be big stuff. No. He said, your faith will remain and you'll strengthen the brethren. See, that's why tonight my heart's going out to you. Because, Paul, you have people on your platform who minister and they're anointed, but they're not at peace. Preachers' kids, Christian workers' kids, they're not at peace. I feel so sorry for preachers' kids, for folks that are under pressure. They don't have quiet. Now listen to me. Here's the beauty. Judges says, and there was quiet in the land. Why? He sent deliverers. Please hear me tonight. He doesn't send deliverers anymore. He sent the deliverer. His name is Jesus. He's always ready. And you may go through the time of peace, and it's so wonderful. I'm in it right now. I'm in it. See, some of you have heard my testimony enough to know. I've told you, and this always is tough. I know your heart goes over my wife. I love beautiful women. Okay? You say, I thought God set you free. He did. But he didn't blind me. He freed me. I think women are beautiful. Now, don't scold me and don't get this religious snobbishness. I'm trying to help you. I will sacrifice what you may think of me, allow my wife to suffer with me to try to help you. I want to talk gut level talk. I want to talk where you live. I don't want to play make-believe anymore. There's a lot of beautiful women here tonight. And I want to tell you something. Listen to me. Every single one of them can look straight into my eyes. I don't lust after you. I don't lust after you. And by the grace of God, and only by the grace of God, I will not. Last night when I came home, I don't know how my wife started watching it, but she was watching The Nightingales. And I've never seen it. But she was watching. She got some little quirk, you know, like a lot of you women watch soap operas. You might as well go to X-rated movies. It's junk. It's flat junk. It's tearing up homes, families, and a lot of folks are hooked on it. No Christian ought to watch it. Let me tell you something. If you get free, and this is where I'm trying to help you. I'm not scolding you. My wife wasn't hooked on that, so she just happened to get seeing it. She probably didn't even realize it was Nightingales. But man, I came in about the time there must have been 10 of these Nightingale nurses in their underwear. Can I tell you, they don't pick ugly women to be on The Nightingales. Now, all you big shot church folks, come off your high horse. I'm trying to help some hurting people tonight. I turned to my wife last night, and these were beautiful women, and they were not clothed properly. And I'm sorry the program's on the air, period. And I'll not be watching it. But those women were there in their underwear, and they were beautiful. I turned to my wife. I said, I got to tell you something right now. I don't want to see that. I don't want to look at that. I can't explain it, but I'm not glad about that. You may not think that's any big deal, but it is for me. I can't do that. And you can't pray over me long enough to do that. What I was saying was, either you turn it off, I've got to leave. I wasn't going to leave because I was lusting. I was going to leave because I just didn't want to see him. There's quiet in the land. When you want to see it, it's noisy in the land. I've experienced noise. And I've experienced quiet. And the mystery is that the church is supposed to announce to the rulers in the heavenlies the purpose of God. And what is that? We came to trample you rulers under our feet like dust. To set captives free so that spirits don't control you. Now I'm going to get real personal. I'm going to talk where you live. This is Dallas. What was wrong with Mark Aguirre? God, how could a guy with such big legs move so cool? How could a guy that didn't look like a basketball player, what a talent. What was wrong with Mark Aguirre? Spirit problem. There was a spirit ministry to Mark Aguirre. The last time I was at the game, I saw you there. Don and his sweet wife, Don George. Mark came by me. I don't know if he knew me. I didn't care. But Mark looked at me like he looked at a lot of the crowd much of the time. Oh, God. I wanted to help Mark so bad. Maybe I missed God. I wanted to try to get him to go play golf. But you know what Mark needed? Mark, I hope you hear this. Because, man, you're a neat guy. You don't have a bad personality, Mark. You got a spirit ministering to you, partner. You got a spirit, old buddy. And it's tearing you up. And you can be delivered from that spirit. You can see those spirits. Don't applaud. You're applauding because you know it's true. But I'm trying to help you see spirits on people. They're spirits on people. They shape them. They affect them. That's the real world. What's wrong with Roy Tarpley? Dear God, what a basketball player. The Mavericks don't need Tarpley. Tarpley needs freedom. That's the only way he can ever count. Pray with me. I'm not through preaching to you, but just pray with me. Lord, I pray right now for Roy Tarpley. Jesus, I love that guy so much. What a beautiful gift you've given him. Lord, we want you to bring Roy Tarpley back to Dallas, and not so he can make baskets, but so Roy Tarpley can say, well, you know, the drug program helped, but let me tell you what really broke the yoke. Jesus broke the yoke. Lord, help Roy to know it's Jesus, not religion. Not white power, not black power, not psychological power. It's the power of the gospel that sets Roy Tarpley free from drugs, just like he did Jeff Finhoe, just like he has so many others. Now, folks, listen to me. There's spirits that are ministering to you. Angels and spirits are ministering spirits. The evil spirits minister to your flesh. The angelic holy beings minister to your needs and protection. The evil one has ministered to a lot of you, and I got good news for you tonight. Please hear me. You can have quiet in the land. You can be delivered. Did you hear Jan Crouch say she'd been delivered from depression? Jan, you said, unless you've been there, nobody can understand. Jan, you're right. And there's spirits of oppression. Would you agree that spirits talk to you and accuse you? The last time we prayed together, and I don't think you mind me saying this, Jan, she told me that the devil told her that she should never, and she'd told Paul she probably wouldn't, because you all told me it was true, I'll never be on TBN again, I'll never be on television again. She said, I'm the biggest problem Paul Crouch has, I am nothing, I don't have any ability, nobody really likes me, and I'm going to die, and I want to die, and she thought about it, and that's the last time we prayed. Now, were those spirits? Because all Paul was doing is standing there telling you how much you needed her. I heard you say, Jan, I need you. I need you. Jan, everybody needs you. But the devil lies. It was noisy in her life. Every one of these people have heard it. Dino, you've heard it. Jeff, you've heard it. You all have heard it. You've heard it. The enemy is laying it on you. You don't need a deliverer to come. The deliverer is here. And his name is Jesus. And let me tell you, you can go out of here with quiet in the land. I'm going to tell you something else. It is possible it'll get noisy again. That's the cycle in Judges. That's the cycle in the Old Testament. I don't like the noise. And you can run where there's no more sound of battle or trumpet or war. And you'll die in that land. Or you can stay where there's the sound of the battle. See, it'll get noisy sometimes. And that's when, having stood, you've got to stand. You not only put on the armor, but you stand. And when you hurt, you still stand. And sometimes it's not quiet. But you keep pressing on. Keep holding on. And it'll get quiet. It'll get quiet. So tonight, I want to pray for those of you who say, James, and here's the beauty. If any two agree, I want to agree with you for quiet in your land. I want to agree with you for peace and forgiveness. See, the enemy takes your wrong and accuses you of it, your failure, your recurring failures, and he reminds you of it. And Jesus is telling you the truth. He said, I died for all of it. I live to forgive. I live to enable you to overcome. Now, anybody on television and anybody here in this building who says, I'm sick of the noise. Maybe you've known quiet, peace. Some of you never have known it, but you can. All I want to do tonight is agree with you, and we're going together to present your need to the deliverer. And his name is Jesus. Let me give you a pretty story. You know what we did Christmas while most of you were celebrating the birth of Jesus? We went to a funeral. It was a little tiny casket. It was about this big. You know who was in that casket? Rhonda's baby. Rhonda's little baby. A little boy. A lot of folks wondered, I thought Rhonda was going to have a baby. They don't know. Rhonda had the baby. She miscarried. Oh, she tried. She was so diligent. They sewed up her cervix, hung her by her feet in the hospital to keep the baby from miscarrying. Everybody prayed. But she lost a pretty little boy. I remember when we left the funeral, Rhonda said, he was so perfect. And she said, I don't understand. But Mom and Daddy, a friend told me God has a purpose for everybody's life. And sometimes it just doesn't take very long for the purpose to be fulfilled. And she said, I didn't know my little baby very long, but he sure did bless me. He sure did bless me. Can I tell you, that's quiet in the land that only the deliverer can bring. Folks, I may be doing a poor job of ministering to you, but I want you to have peace. I've gotten so many beautiful letters. I got one right here. I'd love to read it, but I won't. It's not long. But this preacher, he's got every little paragraph. Victory, victory, victory. See it? Victories. Victory, victory. This guy was going to commit suicide, Paul. He's a preacher like Arthur Blessed on the streets. And he called all the preachers, but they wouldn't talk to him. And I can't talk to everybody that calls me. I want you to hear me now. I got a man right here, Grady. I want to just tell you good night right now. Stand up. Grady's crippled up pretty bad, but stand up for me. He's 6'5", cancer all through his body. A dead man a year ago, God's healed him miraculously. Even the doctor saw the cancer leave his body on the everything on the stand. Oh, Grady. Grady's led thousands of preachers through deliverance in our office. Grady's going back home to Muskogee. He and his wife, Carolyn, are going back to Muskogee. We had lunch together today. He first heard me when I was 19 years old before I got married at First Baptist Muskogee. He's loved me ever since. He came to work with us as a volunteer 4 years ago after I preached at Full Gospel out in California. All Grady does all day long is witness and pray with people on the phone. How many folks do you think you've probably led to the Lord over the telephone, Grady? You have any idea at all? Hundreds and hundreds of people, though, isn't it? And several hundred pastors led through deliverance, right? He said he got out of the book of Numbers into the book of Acts, so he's not counting. But I'm going to tell you, he's led hundreds and hundreds of people to Jesus. Boy, I want to tell you, he just blesses me so much. But I had Grady there in the office. I've got another man there now. His name is Tommy Briggs. Tommy's taller than you, Grady. He must be about 6'8" or 9". And all they do is pray with people, minister to people. And I have a lot of people trying to get through to me, and I tell them I'm not anointed to counsel. And I'm really not. That's not a cop-out. I'm not anointed to counsel. I get too involved with people. And so I have to preach, and then I have others who are anointed to do the other. But those men are there to lead people through deliverance. So anytime you try to get to me and I say, please talk to Tommy. That's not a cop-out. Or talk to Grady. See, I'm trying to help you, okay? But this guy, like a lot of folks, and this happens to me frequently, God told me to call him. So I called him when I got to California, because he lived in California. And I said to him, Jay, I love you. He liked to faint it. He said, I think I'm going to die. He'd won so many souls, but he quit loving his wife right. He'd neglected his wife and his children. And I prayed for him. And then on your program that night, Paul, I said to Jay, we're going to pray for you together on TBN. And we did. And sitting in front of that television, Jay not only got free, people called him from TBN audience all over California. And not only ministered to Jay, they supported him. And this dude's going all over the world winning people to Jesus. Victory, victory, victory with his wife and his children. It's awesome. I got this today from Jay Louvier. Jay, hi, I know you're watching if you're in California. And I love you, Jay. God bless you. That's deliverance, folks. There's quiet in the land. So what I want to do with you tonight, at home on television and right here, if you want there to be quiet in the land, you can have that peace. Let me say this to you. You won't get the quiet holding on to the pride. If you're worried about what somebody's going to think you're getting free of, you'll never get free. See, God didn't just free me from some problems I saw. He freed me from things I'd never seen. He had to free me of my reputation and my fear of man and what my own crowd would think about me. He freed me from that. I had to be free from what the denomination thought or anybody thought. Now, he wants to free you. If anybody tonight says, James, I want quiet in the land, I want you to tell those authorities. He said the church announces to the authorities in the heavenlies the purpose of God. And what's the purpose of God to those authorities? We're going to do what he did. We're going to disarm you, make a public display of you, and walk over you like dust under our feet. That's what we're going to do. Now, that's what God wants. So I just want to agree with you. It's not hocus pocus. I'm not going to interview any spirits. We're going to tell them to get, go, leave. If you want them gone, spirit of fear, spirit of fatigue, spirit of oppression, depression, spirit of lust, spirit of perversion, spirit of gluttony, it doesn't matter what, spirit of religion, approval of men, spirit of harlotry, it doesn't matter what it is. You want it to go? Come on down here and just kneel or stand here around the front and I'm going to pray for you. Get up and come right now. You want quiet in the land. Come on quick. You know whether it's quiet in the land. I never forget the musician that came off Ken Copeland's platform when I spoke. Just gave a greeting to him, and the power of God fell. And one of his musicians said, I was going to commit suicide tonight, and God set me free. You can be playing in a gospel band and be living in absolute defeat and misery. You want to be free. You want quiet in the land. You come on. Right now, we're just going to agree. It's not mystical. It's not even tough. I just love you. And by the way, if you're not able to kneel easily, well, just stand. You don't have to kneel. Just stand. Just stand. Now, I want to ask you to do this now. When you kneel or stand, don't get religious. Just be still. If you're able, just be quiet. So easy to try to help God out. Boy, I don't want to waste your time. I want to help you. You want quiet in the land. Boy, I'm so glad you've come. I wish I could talk to all of you personally. I really do. Father, I just thank you for these beautiful people coming. And all of you at home, God will set you free. Listen, right there in your home, get up from where you are and just turn around there at the sofa or at a chair. Just make an altar out of it. And just say, Lord, I'm so tired of the noise, the oppression, the condemnation, the lust, the sin, the rebellion, the rejection, the intimidation, whatever it is, the infirmity. I'm sick of it. I want it gone. I want freedom in my life. Just get on your knees and say, Lord, set me free right here at home. He will. He will. He'll set you free. Now, I want to ask that the music stop and those of you kneeling here, because I just feel I really need to talk to you a moment and then pray with you. Look up here at me, those of you kneeling. I really wish I could talk to you person to person. I mean, but it's not necessary. I see the devil's talking to you right now. Fast as I'm talking, he's talking. A lot of you are saying, I need to talk to you alone. It never fails. I just need to see, the enemy's telling you what you need. See, they went to Jesus and said, if you'll just come over here, my son will get well. He said, he lives. Now, what if it said, no, you come over here. Listen, don't listen to those voices telling you how to get God to operate. I care about you. I mean, I didn't preach an hour and a half because I like to stretch your endurance. This is fatiguing on me. I'm tired already. I was tired physically. Ministers get weary. I'm doing this to help you, okay? Now, some of you have known quiet and peace, but it's noisy now, right? I'm going to ask the Lord to calm the storm. Now, folks, we're not going to have to beg him to do it. We're going to ask him to do it, and we're going to command the enemy to loose you. Now, I want you to watch this. If this microphone were your neck, and the enemy had a yoke, and Jesus came to destroy his effectiveness and his ability to enslave and entangle, and he said you can speak not only to mountains, but you can break the yoke and break the chains and set captives free, and you speak. What did Jesus say to the spirits? Loose them. Come out. Go. Did he say that? And did he say what he did, we do? So if the enemy's got a grip on you, and I tell him, loose him, what does the enemy, by God's word, have to do? All right, now look at this. Look at this. God says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Has the blood been spilt? Is it sufficient? Is it adequate? Is it enough? Was it good enough? It's enough. It's sufficient, right? The blood's there. And by the word of their testimony, right? The word of their testimony. What's the word of your testimony? This is it. By the word of God. Have you heard the word? Is Jesus telling us the word? And then he says one other thing, and this is a kicker. And they love not their life unto death. You know what that means? He said, well, it means to be willing to die for Jesus. No. It means you don't love yourself from now till the day you die. That's how you walk as an overcomer. A lot of you say, oh, I'm going to die. You're loving your life. See, somebody says, you really ought to be here. Somebody says, you got cancer. Praise God, I'll be home soon. I'm telling you the truth. Somehow in your spirit, there's got to get a Holy Spirit joy that just breaks the diagnosis. So what if I do? Don't love my life. You'll probably get well the minute that thought registers deep down in your spirit. And you say, well, what if I don't? We'll die. Heaven ain't a bad deal. You say, well, I love my life. That's part of the problem. Oh, but I love this. I'm telling you, turn it loose. He's better than what you love. He's better than all the stuff. So we don't come down here with idols and self-seeking. We say, Lord, I just want you. Now, I got news for you. For him to live, you die to self. You're crucified with him. You walk out of here, it's Christ that lives in you. You got it? So all we're going to do is say, Lord, I want you. And I want you to get serious with me. When I crawled over in that chair and got a carpet cleaner to pray for me, no big shot. I walked over there. I said, God, it's over for me. It's over. It's got to be in your spirit. Otherwise, we're just playing. I mean, are you just wanting hocus pocus? Or do you want God to deliver? I turned it off, Paul, I think. Did I? It's just dead. Now, hey, don't let this bother this devil. No, I'm not trying to give him undue credit, but you'll be witnessing to people, and they'll be about to get saved, and the phone will ring. Timing. The enemy's in control. This is the real world. He'll short circuit sound systems. He does that kind of stuff. But what we ain't gonna let it bother us. See, we're not let it bother us, okay? Now, if you're ready to be set free, all I have to do is say, turn them loose. Get out. You ready? Father, I thank you for all these precious people that have come tonight to repent. I thank you, Lord, for those in the television audience right there at home that say, I want to be free. We're not in some mystical thing. We are unfolding a mystery. Lord, you said that we could announce to the rulers in the heavenly realm, authorities and principalities, the manifold wisdom, the manifold and eternal purpose of the Lord God himself, and you came to set captives free. So, Father, I ask in the name of the Lord Jesus that you forgive all sin, that you cleanse from sin, that you break the power of sin, the hunger for sin and plant a hunger for righteousness. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking you to break the yoke, open prison doors, break the chains, and set captives free. In the name of Jesus, I command every ruler, every authority, every foul, tormenting, deceptive spirit, every oppressive spirit, every spirit of fear, of lust, every foul spirit to loose you and leave you now. Right now. Loosen in Jesus' name. Loosen. And in the name of Jesus, loose them at home. I speak silence to the enemy. I short circuit in the name of Jesus your communication with these people's minds. I speak confusion on the enemy. I separate, scatter the enemy. I speak confusion on the enemy and peace to the people of God right now. Right now. When the truth makes us free, we're free indeed. Jesus is the truth. I want all of you who are kneeling to stand and look this way. Now, some of you probably would like me to ask, how do you feel? Well, I'm interested, but it isn't an issue. Because when I got set free, I felt nothing. I'm a guy that depends a lot on feeling. God says, you're going to depend on me now, not feeling. By the word, not feeling. A lot of you folks that really like feeling, he's not going to let you have one. He don't want you trusting him. So he had to deal with me that way. No feeling for you, dude. Trust me. I'm here. I said I'm here. You said do it. I said I'll do it. I came to do it. I want to do it. I proved I want to do it. I made public display of him. I died on the cross. I nailed death to the cross, sin to the cross. I defeated the enemy. That's proof. What more you want? You want goosebumps? Or you want reality? Now, if he said he gave us authority, and I told the enemy to loose you, did he have a choice? That means the yoke's broken, friend. Now, I mean, let's settle in on truth. I know the devil's talking. He's a motor mouth. And some of you tuned to channel devil so long, you hear him clearly. I mean, you hear him. He's telling you right now, it didn't work. You know, you tried before. You'll be right back. He's telling some of you, wait till I get you outside. He's talking. And you're listening to all this stuff. Now, I want you to break that noise factor. I want you to say, is that devil? That's not God. So I'm not listening to you anymore. I'm not listening to you. I'm going to listen to God. What did God say? He said, I came to do it. He said, I've given you authority to do it. He said, if any two of you agree, do we agree? Does he agree? He says, it's done. Now that means the yoke's broken. That means you can walk out of here with peace in the land. Let me tell you what you need to do now. As you walk out of here with peace, God's planting a hunger for fellowship with him. If you read the rest of this chapter, why don't you read the rest of it before you go to sleep? He says he wants to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything you ever even dreamed of. Hallelujah. Much less ask for. He said, I want to do beyond what you can ask for. But you know what else he says? He says, I want you to know the surpassing love of Christ shed and poured out in your hearts. And I want you to love one another. Now you go out of here tonight and say, Lord, I'm going to love you. I'm going to love others. I'm going to share you God. I'll be a river. You just flow like that old Professor Charlie Howard. Just whatever you say, I'm going to do it. You go out here and you get your Bible and open it and say, Lord, let the word live. And he says it'll be like honey in your mouth. You go home with a new life, a new liberty, a new freedom, and let the peace come. Now remember this. I told you that even in a time of deliverance, there were times when I still heard the sound of battle. I didn't understand it, but don't get distressed. He's still there. They may be heating the fire up. You're being bound to be thrown in. He says, I'll be there. I'll be right in the middle of it. Don't forget that. That's the truth that sets you free and keeps you free. Amen? Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Thank you, God.
Let's have one final prayer. We've got about a minute and a half, and there are many people watching across this nation that have never really made that commitment to Christ. I know these have. Lead them to Jesus.
Many of you who are watching on television right now, there is a phone number there on the screen. They're prayer partners and counselors, just like old Grady Burris I introduced a moment ago. They're waiting right now to pray with you and lead you to Jesus Christ. I know in my spirit many of you are already calling. to say, I want you to know Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. He's the one that sets you free. He's the one that delivers. He's the one that brings back the peace. Would you right now just go to that telephone as an indication, just like these people came forward. Would you go to that phone and dial the number and say to the prayer partner, and by the way, keep calling until you get through if you get a busy, and just say, I want to know Jesus in my heart personally. I identified with what I heard tonight, and I want freedom and forgiveness in my life, and Jesus will forgive you, and Jesus will save you. God bless you. Call right now.
Thank you, Brother James. Did y'all receive something from the Lord tonight? Let's tell Brother James Robinson, thank you for this tremendously anointed message. Remember, tomorrow night, dear Lord, another Baptist will be here tomorrow night. E.V. Hill, Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church, South Central Los Angeles. We'll all be back for another great live Praise the Lord from Calvary Temple, Irving, Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas. Good night. God love you. We love you. And remember, let everything that hath breath...
We're so glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. If you'd like an audio cassette of Praise the Lord, please write and ask for program 0316-89. That's 0316-89. The dates will be sent for your love gift to the Praise the Lord program. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 23517, Vancouver, AMF, Vancouver, British Columbia, V7B, 1W2. If you would like to contact guests or musicians for their tape, books, or albums, please write us at TBN and we'll forward your correspondence. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout the United States of America.